We know great drum feel when we see it, right? Like Steve Jordan, Nate Smith, Ziggy Mottoist. Or maybe Clyde Stubblefield. And it's not like we don't hear a lot about the importance of feel. Everywhere you look, people are talking about it. So you'd expect drummers the world over to be obsessed with feel, right? And as a result, that the average amateur drummer, if he or she did nothing else right, would at least have a good danceable feel. I'll pick up myself here. This is me playing 15 years ago. Anyway, you who are watching this video, when you record yourself, when you really listen, is your feel good enough? Really? Come on! Yeah, it's probably not. But why? I thought feel was the one thing everybody agreed you needed on drums. Well, it turns out there's a much darker, more interesting truth at the center. And it paints the way to a global conspiracy! Just kidding. Actually, it's just human nature. But we're gonna confront those reasons and flush them out of their holes. Then we're gonna check out a really quirky exercise I came up with that will honestly, really help you improve your feel. If that's really what you want. You'll see what I mean. Anyway, stay tuned. Reason number one, our feel sucks. We secretly think we can already do it. Here's Mark Kohlenberg at Zildjian Underground, back when people used to congregate in rooms to hear live music. Think about how good his feel is, how he's placing the beat perfectly, consistently. Think about how danceable it is. Now, admit it. You probably think you can do that. You probably think if you could just learn the beat structure, what goes where, that you could sit down and play the same beat and it would be pretty much the same. Okay, but that's a pretty easy one. Let's try something harder, something on meter. Here's Nate Smith. It's the new style. Sure, there's some off-kilter, but admit it. You probably think you can do it. Maybe play along for a few bars to get the gist, but then you'd mostly have it. Enough that most people in the club probably wouldn't mind. Admit it! Hey, I'm not trying to make the point that you'd be wrong, just that you secretly think you could do it. One more. Here's a true master, Bernard Purdy. That's a simple one, right? It seems like we'd be able to play that. Maybe the constant eights on the hats would give us some trouble, but we mostly think we could do it. Now, here's my suggestion. Put one of these tracks, which I'll link below, on your headphones and play along. Take as long as you want to get familiar with the beat. Then use something else, whether it's a drum mic, Zoom mic, EAD, or just a friend's phone, to record yourself playing along. Listen back. Does it sound as good as the recording? Does it sound as good as you expected? If you really want to hear it, import the track to GarageBand, Logic, or Ableton, or any recording software. Then make a new track, attach some kind of mic, and play along. Then listen back. Are your snare notes in exactly the same place as the drummer? Are they in the same place every time? Same volume? What about your kick drum? It's probably rushing, isn't it? Come on, it's rushing. I've got two theories about why we think we're so much better at feel than we really are. First is the dance floor theory. You know how when a really groovy song comes on, we forget to be self-conscious of making zero comments about what we may have ingested. We really lose ourselves to the song. Then maybe a friend records us dancing in. Don't, bro, just don't. Put that away.
Don't ever do that again.
Yeah, it turns out we can get lost in the beat, and that feeling has very little to do with how good we sound. Or how well we dance. It's great to unwind and feel good. Don't get me wrong. But it doesn't mean we're great dancers or great drummers. The second theory is the way we learn beats. Unless we've got a church gig, gosh, is it any wonder church drummers are a talent pool? We mostly learn out of books. The Rick Latham book. Realistic Rock. The New Breed. all great books, but we focus on playing what's on the page as the goal. If we play the kick drum where it says on the page and the snare drum in roughly the right place, our teacher will say, "Great job, Jimmy," and put a green check mark above the page, and we get to move on. So we just started to assume that if we could play things the way they were written, if we could technically learn the beat, let alone if we felt the groove inside us, maybe as a result of the other musicians being killing or playing along to a great recording, we were grooving, baby. Reason number two why our feel sucks. We secretly think it's less sexy than Chops. Remember Zach Groove's Omegle videos?
We're gonna go on the world famous website called Omegle. I'm also here to try to prove a point. That point is that Chops are not everything.
He made a bet that people would like groove better.
But we're gonna see if the average non-musician ear prefers groove or Chops.
And a surprising number of people actually wanted Chops.
Now, which one do you like more?
First one.
Listen to this groove from Steve Gadd.
They've got time to burn. There's no me.
Admit it, you probably hope I'm gonna fast forward to this, right? Here's Mark Kohlenberg again. You hear about 5 seconds of that and you're like, "I've got it, let's hear the solo." And don't worry, I've got you guys. Little Nate Wood, perhaps? Hot groove, right? But you're probably hoping I'll share this. But you say, "We're drummers. Of course we want to skip the solo." The general public, however, wants groove. Not so necessarily according to Zach Groove's scientific research.
Because it's just faster and cooler.
Cool.
And look, I'm not saying we don't care at all about pocket or feel, but remember reason one? We sort of feel like if we just learned the beat, we'd have it handled. So we want to watch the thing we think is beyond our abilities. Reason three, we're not actually practicing it. I'm going to ask you a question. It's just you and me here, right? I'm gonna ask you to be honest with me, and more importantly, be honest with yourself. Ready? Do you ever practice pocket?
Show me the money.
Do you ever practice pocket? Or do you play the beat till you get the order of operations, then you're like, "I've got it," and move on? But do you ever play a single groove and try to play every single note in the center of the parking spot? I keep stealing that analogy.
It doesn't mean it's impossible. We will show you guys step by step how to do it the easy way.
Do you ever play with recordings and listen back to only your own playing, not the recording? Do you ever record yourself on a multi-track system and see how much you're really locking up with the original drummer? Whether your snare is right in the center, whether your kick drum is right in the center consistently, in the same volume every time, hey, bring it in. It's okay. We all do it. But how do we fix it? Beyond doing what I just said, let's look at a little trick I discovered this past month. Here I am practicing a straight 16th groove, with the metronome in my headphones. One of the biggest reasons our feel sucks is we're not paying attention to our ghost notes. We're just kind of throwing them down and they're super inconsistent. But ghost notes are the peanut butter that holds the bread and jelly together. And you need the peanut butter. So now watch what I'm gonna do. I take out the rim shots and I play all the lead hand stuff on my leg. Right away, you can hear if your ghost notes are inconsistent volume, rushing, or dragging. You can tell if your hand is too rigid or if it's relaxed. Now, you can add rim shots back in. I'll show you one more. In the next clip, I'm setting the metronome so that it only clicks on beat 4. And I'm going to continue playing with my lead hand on my leg. Not only does this attune your ear to listen to all the ghost strokes, and to make sure that they're consistent, it also forces you to make guesses about where the big beat is, and the metronome will tell you if you're wrong. That's way more effective than just playing with the metronome on downbeats, where you can essentially just follow it. Eventually, add your lead hand back in on the hats or ride cymbal. Want to make it harder? Go really slow.
1, 2, 3.
That's how you improve your feel, and that's how you get the gig. At least, if the gig isn't at Omegle.
Hi.
Shh. Anyway, guys, if you've enjoyed this one, if it's resonated with you, if you feel like, oh my gosh, they're describing me. If you feel like you need to work on your feel a little bit, you're not alone. I was there. Many a drummer finds himself there. And I want you to know, you don't have to solve it on your own. I've solved it. I mean, I'm not saying I'm amazing, but I got better. Not only that, I've taught thousands of drummers the system I used to solve it for myself, and it worked for them. Nate, whatever could you be talking about? Well, I'm glad you asked. What I'm talking about is my coaching course, which is like 3 to 6 months of studying with me, all for around the price of a single lesson. Well, that sounds great, Nate. How do we get into this coaching course? Well, not so fast there, Hotfoot. Here's the thing. One does not simply walk into the coaching course. You need to be on my mailing list. We only open it a few times a year. That's because seating is limited. And if you're asking, no, not every version includes live stuff. It's limited seating because I want to keep the seating small. It's my kingdom. So you're probably wondering, how do we get on the mailing list? Well, here's where it gets better. Not only is all you need to do, click the link below the player and enter your email address in on the next page, I will send you a gift completely free for your troubles. My 3-video mini course. 3 videos which I assert will make your playing better in the next 3 weeks than it's gotten in the previous 6 months. Dudes, it's been real. This needs to be a song. Always enjoy these. See you again in another lesson of the week.